Greetings, students, and welcome to this brief lesson on the indigenous religions. I am Dr. Michael McGowan. Let's get started. All right, here's what we're going to do in this lesson. We're going to first go over some preliminaries, then we'll talk about the name indigenous religions, how many practitioners of indigenous religions there are, what some of the symbols are, whether or not they have scriptures, etc. Then we will apply our comparative approaches, the transformation model and the worldview model. And I'm also going to note why some of these models break down when talking about indigenous religions. And then finally, we're going to close by talking about the symbolist mentality and what the role of the shaman is in indigenous religions. All right, as a preliminary, let's talk about the way people study the subject of religion. And basically the point here is that the study of religion itself changes as the cultural context changes, right? So 100 years ago, if you had had a religion of the world, a religions of the world class, or a comparative religion class, chances are you would not have included Hinduism or Buddhism, because they're just simply weren't on the radar of people in the West nearly to the extent that they are now. 50 years ago, you wouldn't have had a major section of the class dedicated to indigenous religions. They wouldn't have been included in classes or textbooks. Now, why is that? Well, because these traditions are hard to study, not because they're less important or unworthy of study. They're absolutely worthy of study. But because many of these indigenous religions have kind of a scarcity of written or sacred texts, it makes it more difficult to study. And so thankfully, they have been rediscovered through anthropologists, through ecologists, people writing about environmental ethics. They share some of the concerns of practitioners of indigenous religions. And so we have rediscovered them. And for this, we should be thankful because a lot of these traditions are beautiful traditions. And I'll explain towards the end of the lesson why I think they are beautiful traditions. All right. So as I mentioned, the point of this preliminary comment is to say that the study of religion changes as the cultural context changes. And indigenous traditions, they kind of explode our nice and little neat categories we have for grouping people into this or that group, right? Some of the questions that indigenous religions ask are different than those asked by the major world religions. All right, so now let's talk about the name, indigenous. Why do we use this word indigenous? Well, Jeffrey Brood, in his book, Invitation to World Religions, has one answer. He says, quote, although they are practiced on a smaller scale, they are not simpler or more basic than large-scale religions like Judaism or like Christianity, Buddhism, or Islam. Therefore, they should not be considered evidence of a primitive or less developed religious mentality. Rather, indigenous North American religions are highly complex systems of belief and practice with sophisticated cosmologies and firm ethical principles. So this just kind of reaffirms this idea that they are absolutely worthy of study, even though they're practiced on a much smaller scale than some of the major world religions. Michael Malloy, in his book, Experiencing World Religions, has another comment. Quote, there is no agreement on how to speak of these ancient religious ways. Various terms include traditional, aboriginal, indigenous, tribal, non-literate, primal, native, oral, and basic. But each term is inadequate. There is simply no easy solution for naming this group of religious traditions. In a textbook you might have gotten in the mid-20th century, for instance, Houston Smith's The World's Religions, that I'm going to make reference to later in this lesson, calls these primal religions, right? They used to be called primitive, primal, native, etc. But thankfully now we are in a new era in which we're sensitive to the lived experience of indigenous peoples. And so indigenous has the same meaning as like native, but it's more neutral sounding than words like primitive, for instance, because that's it just doesn't match the facts on the ground. These are As the prior quote said, these are traditions with a rich history, with sophisticated cosmologies, with interesting statements about our role in the world and how to connect to the world, etc. So indigenous has the same meaning as native, but it's more neutral sounding than some of the more pejorative terms. All right, so where are they and how many are they? Well, it is hard to say. The numbers are diminishing in some areas of the world. As of 2012, which is a long time ago, I understand, but this is, the latest data from the Pew Research Institute. As of 2012, globally, there are about 400 million, or 6% of the world's population. In the United States, there are just over 1 million. And if you want to get, the absolute latest data, go to the Pew Forum and find some of their polls. Now, where are they located? Well, they're basically located everywhere: in China, in Africa, Australia, Southeast Asia, the Pacific Islands, Siberia, and in North America as well, with Native Americans. Here is a map that shows kind of a regional distribution of folk religionists, and you'll see the numbers I just took are directly from this map. And the vast majority of them live in the Asia Pacific region. And this has to do with kind of folk religion in China and Japan, etc. However, they are found in every continent on Earth, basically. Here are some more charts to kind of show you the numbers. There's projected global folk religion population from 2010 to 2050, and you can see as a percentage of the world's population, they are decreasing over time. So in 2010, there was almost 6% of the world's population. By 2050, it's estimated that less than 5% of the world's population will be kind of a member, although it's not an official membership per se. They'll be practitioners of these folk religions. The second chart there goes over projected compound annual growth rates for folk religions between 5-year periods. And you can see that the growth rate is diminishing as well, right? Every 5 years, for instance, there's the difference between the world growth rate and the folk religion growth rate. And then finally, change in regional distribution of folk religions, 2010 versus 2050. And this is interesting, right? Because, some of these numbers are increasing, right? So their locations are changing. The regional distribution of folk religions is changing. And most notably, scholars are predicting that sub-Saharan Africa is basically going to double, right? 6.7% to 13.7% by the year 2050. So, as I mentioned, you can go to the Pew Research Center for more information about indigenous religions and where they are located. All right, let's talk briefly about their symbols. It, of course, will depend on which group we're talking about, right? The symbols for African indigenous traditions and North American indigenous traditions are going to be different. In North America, the Native Americans hold in high esteem the four-pointed star. It is said to represent courage and purity. And it's also the case that some practitioners of indigenous religions can be offended at the frivolous use of some of their symbols, right? I mean, just think about it. What do we put on top of our Christmas tree? Well, we put a star. Well, that star has a rich history in indigenous traditions. Of course, it does in the Christmas story as well. But when people put it up without any thought to its history, some people can be offended at that. Or at least that's an argument made by Wynne Corduan in his book, Guide to World Religions, page 137. All right, what about scriptures? Well, this is where it gets interesting. And as I mentioned earlier, the indigenous traditions don't really have scriptures in the way that the major world religions have them, right? Instead, information is not passed on generation to generation through texts, but rather it's conveyed orally. And this brings up, at least in my mind, the end scene of the old version of Ray Bradbury's Fahrenheit 451. I don't know if you probably have not seen the old version of Fahrenheit 451, but at the end, There's a group of people who are transmitting information and stories and histories and a culture, the entire culture's narratives. They're transmitting them orally. And if we were in a classroom right now, I would show you that clip because it's kind of a powerful clip. Here's what Brood says about it in his book. Quote, "Most myths of the Americas have been transmitted orally. Other native myths do not describe the creation of humans, but instead account for their emergence on the surface of the earth. Native mythologies contain teachings about how to live properly in the world. From myths, people learn to live respectfully with others in society, to make a living off the land, and to understand the meaning of life." Now think about this. Those are all things that, you know, if you're a Christian, that the Bible does, if you are a Jew, that the Hebrew Bible does, that the Quran does, right? That the sacred texts of the world religions, they have these similar goals, these similar objectives to teach people to live respectfully with other people, to make a living, right? To understand the meaning of life. These are existential questions that oral traditions can transmit just as well as written traditions. Although it helps scholars, I will say this as a scholar, it helps scholars when there's a written record, which most indigenous traditions throughout their history have not had written records. Here's the way Malloy describes it, quote, "Native religions often express themselves in ways that have less permanence," right? Think about it. A written text has permanence and it can be preserved, and we have records for the great world religions, right? We have records, written texts, sacred texts that date thousands of years. They're thousands of years old, right? But native religions express themselves in ways that have less permanence than that. Like, for instance, dance, or masks, or wood sculpture, paintings that utilize mineral plant dyes, tattoos, body painting, and memorized story and chant. These methods provide a kind of scripture to their adherents. So they have the same function in the culture without the actual written scripture. All right, well, how about the comparative approaches? As you'll remember, the transformation model asks each of the world's religions what it's intending to do, right? What problem is it intending to solve? And usually that problem is not like a mundane or trivial problem, but rather it's a significant problem. In Judaism, for instance, the idea was broken covenant. In Islam, the idea is pride. In Christianity, the idea is sin, right? These are the problems those religions are intending to solve. The transformation model also suggests that there is a goal, which will mean the elimination or overturning of that problem. And then, if there's a problem and a solution, then usually there's a means of transformation, how to get from problem to solution. That's the transformation model. The worldview model asks about humanity. Who and what are we, right? How did we get here? It also asks about the cosmos. What's the origin story of the universe? Right? There are some wild origin stories in some of the religious traditions that we talk about in this class. So the worldview model considers humanity, cosmos, and society as well. How should societies be organized? Right? These are questions in the worldview model. But we need to ask, when we're exploring the indigenous religions, will these models even work for these kinds of religion? Well, you can probably guess, if I'm asking the question, that no, they won't work. Right? They don't work with indigenous religions. Why they don't work? I'm going to give you three reasons why they don't work. The first has to do with timing or a timeline, right? The second has to do with not really having a problem and not really having distinctions. And then the third has to do with symbolist mentality. And so I'm going to elaborate on each one. The central issue having to do with the timeline is that these indigenous religions, they existed long before the historic religions that scholars mainly study now. The historic religions, you could argue, they started, what, 4,000 years ago? And among scholars, at least, sometimes this idea of whatever comes later is better. Now, Houston Smith says this sort of approach to it began in the 19th century. You could argue it began earlier. But the result is that scholars in the past viewed these as uncivilized or savage people, uncivilized religions, unsophisticated religions. And scholars thought if there's no written record, then there's nothing to study. And of course, that couldn't be further from the truth. There is a lot to study. And I'm going to let Houston Smith kind of talk about the difference between how indigenous religions view time and how some of the major world religions do, or at least the Abrahamic and monotheistic ones. Here's what he says in his book, The World's Religions, page 372. Quote, "Primal time is not linear time." Now, remember, he calls these primal religions. He's writing in the mid-20th century. We don't refer to them as primal religions anymore, but that's how he refers to them. Quote, "Primal time is not linear, a straight line that moves from the past through the present into the future. It is not even cyclical, as the Asian religions tend to regard it, turning in the way the world turns and seasons cycle. Primal time is atemporal, an eternal now. To speak of atemporal or timeless time is paradoxical, but the paradox can be relieved if we see that primal time focuses on causal rather than chronological sequence. For primal peoples, past simply means preeminently closer to the originating source of things. That the source precedes the present is of secondary importance." So that'll give you some sense of how many of these indigenous religions view time itself, right? Smith's quote here helps us understand that. All right, what about the second reason why our models break down when approaching the indigenous religions? Well, as I mentioned, the transformation model suggests that most religions are responding to like an existential problem. But the problem in applying these religions to, or applying these models to indigenous religions is that there is no clear problem confronting all humans. There are only local or contextual problems. So if there's not a problem, then there's no clear salvation from the problem. And if there isn't a problem and there's no solution, no solution necessary because there's not a major existential, like global problem to which it's responding, there's no salvation from the problem, then there will be no mode of transformation. There's no need for that kind of transformation in the same way that there would be in the major world religions. Also, there are no distinctions. In the worldview model, you could evaluate humanity and the cosmos and society, but evaluating the self and evaluating the cosmos and society as distinct doesn't really make sense to primal religions, to indigenous religions, right? And we need to ask why, too. Existence, according to the indigenous religions, is cut of like this single piece and fabric is woven tightly. You can't draw firm distinctions between self and the world and society. They're not all that different from one another. And so here are some quotes about not really having distinctions in the same way that the other world religions suggest that there are distinctions. From Black Elk Speaks, this is a transcribed interview with a Native American leader a long time ago. He says this, quote, "Ours is the story of all life that is holy and is good to tell, and of us two-leggeds sharing in it with the four-leggeds and the wings of the air and all green things. For these are the children of one mother, and their father is one spirit." In other words, the self is part of the world, right? It's not separate from it such that you can have distinctions between self and cosmos or self and society. Here's the way it's presented in the Invitation to World Religions. Quote, "Many indigenous North American religions emphasize the interrelationships of all things. The elements of creation, humans included, are often thought to share a common spiritual energy or sacred power. This may be understood as a life force or as the presence of a supreme being," right? And then Michael Malloy, in Experiencing World Religions, phrases it this way. In the worldview of these religions, human beings are very much a part of nature. Right? Yeah. All right. Finally, let's talk about one of the most fascinating aspects of the indigenous religions, and that is what Houston Smith, in his book, The World Religions, what he calls the symbolist mentality. Basically, here's how it works. Everything in the world is, quote, transparent to transcendence. So this includes physical, mental, animal, vegetable, non-ordinary, etc. It is all transparent to transcendence. Everything can be a symbol or an opening to something beyond itself. Right? And when the world is symbolist, then the world is an opening through which the inexhaustible energies of the cosmos pour into existence. That's a powerful idea, and it's one of the reasons I love the indigenous religions. I love talking about them because of how they see the world. You know? The world, according to the symbolist mentality, is kind of like a window. It allows us to see something beyond it while also recognizing that we are part of it, right? Here's the way it's in Invitation to World Religions. Here's the way it is talked about. Quote, the entire world and the many elements within it may be believed to be infused by the spiritual essence of a supreme being or great spirit. Malloy, in his book, talks about it this way. Quote, the life force is present in everything. Trees, plants, birds, animals, human beings, water, the sun, the moon, clouds or wind, mountains, rocks, soil, basically everything can be seen as part of the same reality, right? This gets back to the idea of there being no distinctions. There may be no clear boundaries between the natural and supernatural and between human and non-human. Yeah. Houston Smith talks about it this way. This, quote, is probably the most single feature of living primal spirituality, namely what has been called its symbolist mentality. The symbolist vision sees the things of this world as transparent to their divine source. And then Black Elk speaks, that interview that was transcribed a long time ago. Here's the way Black Elk talked about it. Quote, it is often difficult for those who look on the tradition of the red man from the outside or through the educated mind to understand that no object is what it appears to be, but it is simply the pale shadow of reality, capital R, reality. It is for this reason that every created object is holy and has a power according to the loftiness of the spiritual reality that it reflects. Yeah, so the symbolist mentality, I think, is one of the most fascinating features of the indigenous religions, and I think it could actually change the way we go through the world, the way we interpret the things happening around us, the way we react to people, the way we take care of nature, etc. And the idea is if your window into ultimate reality gets dirty, or it's painted, or you can't see beyond it, right? Then the primal or indigenous religions really work to keep that window clean. And the point is that the beyond is visible through the existence of the particulars of this world. And if we were in a classroom, I would show you a video clip of David Foster Wallace, who is an American novelist. He gave a graduation speech in 2005 to the Kenyon College class of graduating seniors. And in this speech, he talks about how even something like a supermarket, at the end of a day, it's crowded, the lines are long, and you have to navigate your junky cart through all these like stuffed, these aisles that are just stuffed with basically more than you could ever want, right? It's not a pleasant experience, but even something like that, even a consumer hell type of situation, can be, what he says, almost sacred. And I think that illustrates this indigenous approach to the symbolist mentality. And I wish if we were in an actual classroom, I could show it to you. All right, finally, let's close by talking about the shaman. Right? In Houston Smith's World Religions, he talks about the shaman role in the world's religions. He says this, quote, "The shaman is widespread but not universal in tribal societies, and the shaman can bypass symbolism and perceive spiritual realities directly." He further says, "We can think of shamans as spiritual savants." And if you don't know what that word savant means, it kind of means genius, set apart, right? Exceptional to the point of belonging to a different order of magnitude, right? What Roger Federer was in tennis, what Michael Jordan was in basketball, right? These are savants in their area. You can think of shamans as spiritual savants. That's what Smith is arguing. And he also says this, quote, "These powers enable them to engage with spirits, both good and evil, drawing power from the former and battling the latter where need be. They are heavily engaged in healing and appear to have preternatural powers to foretell the future and discern lost objects." I've never met an actual shaman, but I would love to one day. They sound like fascinating people, belonging to a different order of magnitude, right? This is the shaman role in the indigenous traditions. All right, I'm going to give you three assignments, and these are the lessons from indigenous religions. Of course, I'm not going to check in or grade you on this, but hopefully, if you can learn to see the world as transparent to some sort of divine source, this is one of the lessons of the indigenous traditions. If you can learn to see the world as transparent to a divine source, maybe it'll help you be friendly to other people, or hospitable to other people, or charitable to the people you don't know very well or agree with, anyone who's an unfamiliar other. That's one of the lessons of the indigenous traditions. If it is the case that they are transparent to transcendence, right? Maybe be nice to them. A second thing you can do is try and see things, not only people, but objects, the earth we live on, as transparent to transcendence as well. Look for the magical in the mundane. These are lessons from the indigenous traditions. All right, that's all I wanted to cover in this brief lesson. If you have any questions or comments, you know how to reach me, and thank you for watching.